what is called Inspiring Social Worker of the Year, and this is our second year. Different from other, you know, from last year we only had one nominee, and this year, because we received three very strong and very excited nominations. So end up with three nominees, and the nomination committee decided that, you know, there's no way we can find who is better or not better. Definitely we don't want to turn it into a competition. So end up the nomination committee decided that we recommend all the three nominees become the the Inspiring Social Workers of the Year. So today, lecture basically is we invite them to come and give a lecture. But as you can imagine, if three people, each of them, give you a half hour lecture, you will all fall into sleep. Like this. So we're all social workers. So that's why we're trying to find a way to make it more engaging. So today we're going to use a more like a forum Q&A style. But I really, really hope that it's not just I ask questions, they answer the questions, okay? After the first couple of questions, I really want you to ask questions. Any question you want to ask, please feel free and ask. And I can totally get rid of my questions, you know, this chit shit, okay? I can do without it if you have enough questions for that, okay? So see how much we want to know about, you know, some wonderful people's life. So before I we move on, I would like to invite Diane He. She is the Executive Director of BCCS, the OBC Association of Social Workers. Thank you, Diane.
Thank you. Just a note about BC Association of Social Workers. This is the professional association in BC. It's a voluntary, not-for-profit organization. And you are welcome as students to join the organization. There's a very special rate for you. And by doing this, you help us support the social work members, but it's also about promotion of the profession, and it's a voice for social justice. And it's really, really important to have that voice in our society today. So I really encourage you to come and be part. And as part of promotion of the profession, we'd like to recognize outstanding social work practice. And today we have an opportunity to acknowledge and to converse with two of three award recipients of the Inspiring Social Worker Award of the Year. Unfortunately, Gary Thandi wasn't able to be with us, but fortunately, Karen Hodge and Angela Kwok are here, sitting on my right. But before I introduce them, I'd like to say a little bit about Paul Cheng. Of course, this is the Paul Cheng Memorial Lecture. And you already mentioned that this is the second year that we have made this award. But what happened was Marianne Mann approached you, and they then approached BC Association of Social Workers to see if we could put together an award in honor of a very special social worker in BC, who was also a graduate of UBC. So in memory of Paul Cheng, we established this award along with the BC Association of Social Work Board itself. For over 40 years, Paul Cheng dedicated his life to serving marginalized members of society. He was one of the first to offer assistance to a boatload of Fijian Chinese refugees who were victims of human trafficking and had arrived on the BC coast. He mentored and inspired many students throughout his career, and I'm told that he found the most satisfaction from working with street youth and people with addictions. And Paul's dedication to his work won him public and personal recognition, including an award from the province for service to the public. Now, social work is a calling which requires practitioners to have a strong commitment, caring, and for social justice. You're not here by accident. You chose this profession for a reason. It has meaning to you. And I think that passion and meaning is probably one of the characteristics that define social workers. So, we tend to be a little modest about our profession and what we actually bring to society and our service. So it can be a little difficult sometimes to get us to blow our own horn or to even recognize social workers who have really led the way in terms of the programs and the service that they've brought to us. So in a way, Karen and Angela, who are sitting here, are here on behalf of many, many social workers across BC, across Canada, who every day contribute in some way and go that extra mile on behalf of the folks who are vulnerable or in need for that day, that period of time, that issue, that program, that policy. We work in so many ways and so many levels. So I really want to thank them for being willing to come and speak with us today. I'm going to be fairly brief about their backgrounds and their extensive backgrounds, histories, and experience, because I really want you to take the time to converse with them. So Karen Hodge, on my right, practiced social work in Nova Scotia, Ontario, and BC. And due to a spinal injury, she's faced some challenges in her life. But she's never let injury stop her from achieving her goals. She's currently a pediatric social worker at Sunnyhill Health Center, and she's a passionate advocate for spinal cord injury care. Now, my impression of Karen is nothing stops Karen. So then, briefly, a little bit about Angela Kwok. She's been the executive director of the BC Centre for Ability since 2005. She's published many articles on family-centered practice, and she sat and sits on advisory committees, including the Persons with Disabilities Advisory Committee, the Advisory Committee of the Center for Inclusion and Citizenship. Present, she's a member of the Advisory Committee on Children and Youth with Special Needs for the Office of the Representative for Children and Youth. Now, my impression of Angela is she's an extraordinary organizer. Angela makes things happen. Now, our third recipient, who unfortunately could not be here, Gary Thandi, he's worked as a probation officer, counselor, hospital social worker, program manager. Currently, he's the head of the nonprofit collaborative Moving Forward Family Services that provides low barrier counseling and support services to residents of Metro Vancouver and the Fraser Valley. Now, this organization's mandate is to provide counseling to anyone who needs it. And as well, they partner with as many agencies as possible in order to overcome silos within social service. He's also a freelance writer and writes nonfiction, and he's a novel coming out for young adults in the future. So my impression of Gary was he's an expert in the area of barrier removals. I invite you to join us at the BC Fall Conference to hear more from this year's dynamic recipients of the Inspiring Social Worker Award, because they're going to put in a second appearance November 4th and 5th on Saturday afternoon at our conference. And at that time, we'll be presenting their awards to them. So now, over to you, Mew.
I believe on your table you should have, not everybody will have a copy, but there will be some copy of today's program for the Project Memorial Lecture. And all the three awardees, okay, the information are here, so if you want to know more about your life, please do. And also after the lecture, if you still have time and you want to know more about them, please do come forward and introduce yourself to them and ask more questions if you like. Before I start, I just want to make sure that, you know, they have whatever they're going to say and whatever they're going to do will be captured by the video camera.
Yes.
Is it good?
Yeah, it's good.
Okay, great. So if you want to ask questions, which I really want you to, in order for us to capture your voice into the video camera, which will be basically shown on our school website and also at the BCASW website, please do go and grab the mic and use the mic to ask a question. Okay, so I'm throwing some questions for our guests to answer first, and hopefully those questions can raise more questions from you, okay? First question I have for you, Angie and Karen, is can you describe, briefly share a incident or a person or a personal story that you think that has inspired you, inspired your social career, and why this person or event or incident?
I would say that one of the person that really inspired me is when I was going to graduate school, I was looking for a place to stay. And then through the words of mouth, somebody told me that there was this one social worker who is puts an apartment and then is going to sublet the room. So I thought, that's great. It's very close to the university. And I need a place to stay. So I went to see this lady and find out that she is somebody who has polio. In fact, that she developed polio when she was an adult. She was a nurse, and at the age of 26, she somehow contracted polio. And she was pretty much impacted in her upper body. She has she has very limited use of her upper body. She has a hand brace, and she can only use two or three fingers. So initially, I got to know her as a roommate. And then, you know, coincidentally, I have my fieldwork placement in the same rehab hospital setting as she was working as a social worker, which is a big complex. They have the acute care on one side and the rehab hospital on the other side. So why is she so impressive? First of all, this is one woman that nothing stopped. Meeting her and getting to know her as a roommate and also somebody that worked in the field really totally changed my perception and my belief on person with disabilities. She always said to me, you know, the only barrier for me is fear and lack of aspiration. The rest is just not that significant. And you know, like through working with, she actually taught me a lot of things, not just about working with people in the hospital, working with patients in the hospital, working with clients. We have so much fun just, you know, living together. She has a lady that come and help her in the morning because she really needs personal help to get dressed and get ready. And one day, I went to school in Wisconsin, you know, there's lots of snow in Wisconsin. And, you know, sometime we got caught by a snowstorm. Her personal support person didn't show up. So, and she need to get dressed. Now, she is some person that doesn't compromise just because she has a disability. She dressed very meticulously. She has her hair done a certain way, and she needs to put her earrings on and her makeup on. It's one thing to put your own earrings on, but trying to put somebody's earrings on and do their hair is a different story. In fact, that she told me that she had a few curls in her hair. I had long straight hair to my waist when I was young, and I never put a roller in it. And she said, well, I said, I have no clue how to do this. She said, I'm going to show. I look at her and say, how are you going to show me? She said, okay, I'm going to sit. You sit on the floor. I am going to use my toes to show you how to do it on your hip. I have to tell you, that was so amazing. I actually learned how to do it. In fact, since then, I learned a lot of this kind of trick. Or the time that I had to put on a bookcase together, and I'm not the best in looking at those diagrams, so I came and put all those. And so she said, I show you how. And so I said, I need somebody to hold up these pieces of wood. She said, okay, that's okay. She sat on the floor and used her feet to do that. So that tells you her resilience. That tells you about her problem-solving skill. But more importantly, what she taught me all through, it really changed my work with persons with disabilities because really she taught me about possibilities and potentials and the importance to look through a different lens when we work with people with special needs. That sometimes we just get so blocked by what they cannot do. We don't see their strength. We don't see their abilities. You know, like that is very, very impressive, and it really changed my way of seeing and working with people with disabilities. After I graduated, I kept in touch with her. She was working as a social worker. And you know what she was doing? You know, like after a few years that I left school, she was teaching medical school. She was teaching medical students how to work, how to explain disabilities to a person who just acquired a disability and ending up with a special child. So to me, she is really an inspiration in my work.
To be completely honest, I don't remember a social worker at all throughout any of that journey. I was in two different hospitals, one in Nova Scotia, one in Ontario, and then at an adult rehabilitation center. Looking back, I think they were primarily working with my parents because I was 15, so they were more so supporting mom and dad. How I actually came to do social work was when I was in my undergrad, I changed my mind every couple of weeks about what I wanted to do. I was doing a Bachelor of Arts with an undergrad major in English literature, and so we used to joke that BA back now probably still means begin again, so finish that or something. So I was looking at what are options. I took a part-time job just to help pay the bills, being a secretary for two social workers who worked in the community living movement in Halifax, so they were supporting families caring for children and young adults with developmental disabilities. And I kind of thought, oh, their work looks really interesting, and I've always been interested in human service work. So I applied to go to Carleton and did my Bachelor of Social Work at Carleton. I didn't look at what the wages are for social workers or the burnout rate. I'm glad that I didn't, because I know so I think partly what brought me to this was seeing their experience. I think partly that experience of being a 15-year-old in a hospital setting where my parents got a lot of support, and I don't think I necessarily got a lot of the social emotional support, wanting to bring that to my practice. I got a lot of support from the physios and the occupational therapist because I spent day to day with them learning things that were really hard. Learning how to get dressed again when you're 15 is pretty frustrating. Learning how to get around, trying to figure out how I was going to dance, how I was going to go on dates. I was doing that more with the therapist. So I think that experience has brought to my practice is I recognize that people connect with the person that's the best fit personality, but my role as a social worker is to support those therapists to best be able to support those clients. So my work isn't always direct, it's often indirect as well.
Okay, thank you. Okay, anyone want to follow up a question for them? On this? Anyone of you find this really fascinated? Unbelievable. Yes. Go for it.
Question. It's so scary. So both of you working with people with disabilities in like really different institutional settings or institutions. How do you find, or do you find as social workers, you come across systemic oppression within the structures you work with, and like your issues in your teams or that, and how do you deal with that as a
staff
worker?
How to deal with this interdisciplinary team? I worked in a line work for many years. I moved up the system. I was line work, and then I was doing supervisory work before I applied for the executive director positions. To be honest, my love is to work with people. So, you know, the supervisory job is a little bit further, and now the executive director is even further. However, when I was working line work, it's very interesting to work with the, you know, with the physio, the OT, the speech, and the doctors who sometimes think that they know everything, and who really know a lot about families and know a lot about people. My way of working with them is very much to really be open and also learn also about their job. I try to learn as much as possible what physio does and what OT does and what speech and language therapist does, because the more you get to be able to talk the language, the better they think that they will listen to you. throughout my, you know, like line work years and even my supervisory year, they will say, well, I think that, you know, their situation, once their situation like, okay, you know, we have dying social workers, we have one vacancy. Well, maybe the OT can do the intake. Maybe the, you know, like the OT can do the case management. Or even, you know, like when we have a new program coming in, you know, on brain injury, which is a case management program, initially they argue that, you know, like maybe it should go to the OT, but OT also can do case management. It's a very different scenario because when you are social work trained, you really learn to talk, learn about system. You know that individual with disabilities does not come by themselves. They come with families. They have a system that is important to them. And so those things is not so much in you know, in the learning of other occupation. So one thing I learned is never try to be territorial. Sometimes say, okay, if you think you can do it, you know, like you may want to give it a try. The first time when there was the social worker position down, they have somebody do it, the intake within 2 weeks. They say, we think it's better to have a social worker. And the second thing, the second time when we have a program, they think that the director of OT could manage it. First of all, I never was, you know, the director of social work, I mean, the OT invited me to all the external advisory meeting, and within 3 months, she went to the executive director and said, I think this should be under the supervision of social work. The more we share, you know, like, we need to remember the ultimate goal that what we want to do. We want to, you know, work with families, work with individuals to improve the quality of life and make things better for them. So if some person say that they could do it, I don't mind to, you know, to do knowledge transfer, to teach them the skill. The more you help them to understand the complexity, the challenges, and some of the stuff you need to address, the more they can recognize your skill sets. The worst thing is to be territorial, because when you're being territorial, then you're putting a wall. You know, and there are situations, especially in the community they work with, I work with individuals or families who have really bad experience with social workers. I hate to say that. You know, their kids were being taken away by the child welfare people, and when they hear the word social workers, they, I don't need to see her because I'm just coming because my child needs physio. However, we know that this family is social work input. Maybe the way to enter into this relationship initially to really, you know, like have the family, you know, work with the person they have the most trusting relationship with. It could be the physio, you know, telling them the resources so they can tell family. And you need to build up their relationships with their family eventually. So that's how I handle it.
I think, for me, definitely, I think no matter where you work, if it's disability, if it's addictions, mental health, you do see gaps in the system. I had posted on Facebook a couple of weeks ago that I kind of felt that I was at the point in my career where my rose-colored glasses had kind of fallen off and my superhero cape was a little tattered, because I could no longer kind of blame the gaps that I was seeing as, oh, well, that person didn't make that phone call or they made a bad choice. I was starting to see, it wasn't just one-offs, I was starting to see patterns, but I didn't necessarily feel I had the power or the resources to make a change or to identify that. And so that sat on my Facebook page for probably a couple of hours, and a bunch of my social work friends posted, like, are you okay? Are you burnt out? Do you need help? And I was like, no, it's just a... But I think what I realized as I reflected throughout the day was actually a lot of what we do as social work is advocacy, but very gentle and very much pushing, pushing, pushing. And we don't always have a light bulb moment where we see black from, like, something changes from black to white. It often changes at a really glacial pace. But I think it's having that opportunity and taking that time to look back to say, okay, I mentioned that in a meeting a year ago, but now things have changed, and now I do see a difference. And now, and keeping that in mind, that we can make a difference even if it's just little tiny steps, because over a long period of time, you know, we can make things change quite drastically, but we sometimes lose sight of that. Does that make sense?
Yeah. Totally. I personally think this is the best way to do our job. When I was teaching 200, which is the prerequisite course, the first thing I asked the student is, how many of you want to come here to the program to change the world? and some did raise their hand, and I said, you might have gone into a wrong profession. Mm-hmm. We don't change the world in that way. We change the world in a more gradually, slowly pushing way, like, you know, what Karen said. Okay, I think this is really, really good example for us. Anyone want to follow up with what have been shared? Okay, just a sec.
I need a mic.
Yeah. The video camera needs a mic. Who are you? Introduce yourself first.
Well, I have already, but I'm Sandra again, equity co-chair. Hi. And I'm curious, sort of following on the previous question, you mentioned having clients who have really negative impressions of social workers, and I'm wondering, you know, there's probably some who have really negative experiences with hospitals and medical settings. I'm wondering how you model and create some safer spaces for your clients, and how you would like keep those boundaries and make people feel safer in those spaces they don't feel comfortable.
I think for me, I worked on outpatients, so families receive a letter saying that you're booked for the physician at this time, the social worker at this time, OT at this time. During the intake process, somebody is supposed to explain to the families what each of those appointments is going to look like, but that doesn't always happen. So I start all of my sessions with families as, has anyone explained to you what the role of social work is on this team? Because social work is different in different contexts. That sometimes can kind of set ease a little bit. I'll say, everybody else on the team is looking at how your child's body is working or how their brain is working, and my role is to check in and see how you're doing as a family to make sure that you're well supported and to connect you with the resources that are available in the community to help you on this journey long term. I also, one of my first intake or assessment questions is often, have you ever met with a social worker before at some point? Was it either in the hospital or in the community? And that often gives me a bit of information and opens the door for them to share, oh, I had a social worker in Emerge 6 weeks ago and they were horrendous, or to kind of learn from their story. In regards to creating a safe space, we have to advocate quite strongly to maintain private spaces to meet families, where I'm often asked to do an assessment. Oh, the families don't have much time, can you do a joint assessment with the physio? Or, oh, I don't have much time, can you go with the rec therapist? And I really try and protect my time alone with the families so that they can be honest or open and to share some of those difficult things. I think in real training, we as social workers learn we learn the courage to be vulnerable, both for ourselves and to be comfortable with vulnerability with our clients, to create that space for them to be able to ask questions or to share things that are quite intimate and quite scary. And I think that just kind of comes as you learn that over time. I also, essential items for my office are, I pay out of my own pocket to have the soft Kleenex, not the hospital Kleenex, but the sandpaper. People reuse the sandpaper and then they have red eyes and then they're embarrassed to leave my office. I buy the stuff with the lotion in it. Both for families and also staff. We also often, as social workers, end up supporting our colleagues when they've had a different interaction with a family or a different interaction in their own life. The other trick that I have is I always have a drawer full of chocolate, so I always offer chocolate to families to kind of put them together at the end of my session. So I think that's how you can create a space. I also try to have in my office pictures or images that anyone can connect to, or it's because I work with children, I have a set of dolls and I bought a set of accessories that are disabilities. So when I do a chart review, I try and dress the doll to look like the child who's coming in. So if I see that the child has glasses and is a boy and uses a walker, I'll try and have the doll set up to look like that so that the child and the family can see themselves in the environment that they're coming into. I think that's just a really small way to create a safe space.
In the workplace that I work with, we do a lot of home-based and community-based services, and it does have a different connotation when you visit people in their own home, because they're the master of their own house. And respecting the space is really important. And I think that, you know, your positive regard to them, if you genuinely care for them, you know, not what you say, but how you, you know, act and how you come across. Families are bright people. They can pick them up. They may try out to see how much you care about them. And they may test you over and over again. be patient, be honest, be transparent. And you know, if I have concern, I always, when I work with families, you know, like I give them a lot of time so that they can tell me what bothered them. And sometimes it takes me a long while to get to the first things. I had parents when I was doing line work swore at me, scream and yell and say all kinds of things. Well, I just listened and really, you know, reflected on it must be really hard to have a child with special needs and experience all those challenges. I don't promise miracle because I'm not a miracle worker. In fact, I don't believe that we can solve other people's problems. We can only work together in partnership to solve problems. So I make it very clear what I can support them with and what I can do and what I cannot do. And sometimes they may ask me to do really, really like things far out. You know, like I have one time. This is a family that was referred to us because she was being declared and non-compliant. She has a child with a lot of needs. Her child go to 3-4 clinics at children's hospital, and she was supposed to get physio and OT, you know, like in a center-based setting, and she was not following any appointments. When I went to see her, you know, like she, you know, like first of all, I'm not going to say you're referred to us because you're not compliant. I talked to her and just find out what her needs are, and you know, and from the conversations, it became clear why she didn't go take the child to those appointments. Because she is car sick. She can't go on a bus. And her kid has so many experiences in the hospital since the child was born that even closer to children's hospital, she starts screaming. And she projectile vomit when she's upset. So can you imagine you want to take a kid, you know, throwing up like that every time you go on the bus? And then, you know, like you yourself cannot sit on the bus. So that gave me a difference. But the only reason why I get that story is because I let her talk rather than me trying to find out what I can help her with. And, you know, so when she went through that process, I said, well, is there anything I can make a difference? You know what her suggestion was? Can you help me to look for a car? That's not exactly a difficult job. It's not in my job description. I said, well, I cannot do it during my work hour, but I don't mind, you know, on a Saturday afternoon to go with you. That egg in itself won her over. And she never asked me to expand my, you know, my job description. So we need to really know how we can make connections with people, because, you know, when we work with people, the parents are, you know, really following all the regime that you know, recommendations, that those are the parents nobody talk about. The parents that family talk about are the ones that giving the team a lot of headache because they are not following through. That's what social worker hear all the time. But sometimes they're not following through is because that's not their priorities of following through. There's some other challenges. Really, if you have a family who has no food at home, parents lost the job, okay about physio?
I think one of the gifts of social work is having the opportunity to be with families and help families go beyond the script.
Yes.
So we all, anytime you've had a rough time in your life, you probably have a set couple of sentences that you use to share it with people. So for me, I shared it with you guys, I think. When I was 15, I woke up one morning, half hour later, I was feeling, my best friend can note that along with me. She can say it word for word, because I say the same thing every time. Our role as social workers is to ask families, how did that feel? What did that look like? What was that like for you? That brings that story to that deeper level, and it creates a sense of trust and allows people to feel heard. And then you often can get the deeper story as to, oh, I don't come to a point. So initially with your mom, it might have been, I don't come to a point because I don't have time. But if you ask the stories, it's like, I'm uncomfortable, I'm scared, I don't know how to get there, I don't know what's happening. Then you can work with that, right? It's hard to work with just that surface level. It's much easier to work with that depth to be able to figure out a solution.
Wait, I want to follow up a question on that. I think this is great. Okay, you know, we understand the way to work with people should start from where they are, right? And to understand, listen to them. But we also talk also to justice. something like, you know, very high up level, very big, and actually the school using social justice as our overarching themes for all our program. So in your work, how do you uphold social justice? You mentioned about, you know, working in institutions, you know, social workers seem to be at the bottom of the hierarchy. And we see lots of, you know, socially unjust, oppressive, you know, conditions. What do you do trying to uphold this, you know, mandate of social work, and how does it translate into your daily practice?
You know, if you look at healthcare and for people with special needs, if you look at the history of Canada, we know that it has gone through, you know, a lot of, you know, evolutions, you know, like from people being put in institution, children being segregated, they're not in the regular school programs. You know, when I first worked in the field, in social work in Vancouver, I, you know, witnessed at that time students who, like, with normal intelligence but with significant physical disabilities were not allowed to go to regular class, regular school, because they're specialized program in the school system. You know, like, and actually two children that I worked with, they were the pioneer. They entered Vancouver School District, you know, like regular school in the early 80s, and they were the first. Well, how do we upheld the justice on many different levels? A lot of time when a parent, you know, confronted with a situation when they have a child with special needs, no matter when the child disability start at birth or they acquire a new injury that become a disability, we almost can tell all 100% of parents go through a period of shock. It seems that a ton of bricks are falling at the end. And, you know, like, and a lot of time they really don't know what's possible and not what's not possible for the child. For the role of the social work, a lot of time is really reframed to them. You know, maybe the child will not achieve the goals the way that they think they will be doing. But we need different strategies for them to reach their aspirations and goals. And so tell them potential and possibility is really important, because if they don't have aspirations, they have hope, they are not going to be able to even support the child to go to deal with those barriers. So empowering families on the individual level is really important, and telling them, you know, what's possible, helping them to make connections with other families who have been a little bit further ahead of their journey is important. That's on the individual level. You know, on the more community level, upholding justice means that we want to build an inclusive community. In order to build an inclusive community, two things are necessary. There's a lot of myth about people and persons with disabilities. Like, for example, like, I know when I first worked in the field in Vancouver, childcare did not accept children with special needs, because they are afraid of them. They don't know how to support them. So education, building community capacity is important. So, like, and I think that, you know, like, in years gone by, we've done a lot of work, you know, promoting, supporting childcare and early child educators, how to support children with special needs, same with employers. So, you know, partnership with community partners to do those educations is important. And on the, you know, macro level, it's really about advocacy. It's about how we, you know, push, you know, like, talk about policy that is not equitable. And that's the reason why I joined a lot of committees. Because, you know, like, as a professional, as a service provider, we do advocacy. We also need to empower families so they can do the advocacy, because they, you know, they may say that we have second agenda, we want more money for our services. But parents, they're the most effective advocates. When they become strong advocates themselves, they can do a lot in, you know, like, in pushing the government, because there's still a lot of gaps in service, there's still a lot of inequity of services. It's for us to really share those information, providing data for families, so we continue to really push for better, you know, quality of services for them. to really build inclusive community that people's rights are being upheld.
I think for me, social justice is recognizing the inherent value in all human beings. I think we live in a society that's really quick to assign blame when somebody doesn't fit easily in a box of label, or isn't easily labeled, or doesn't easily fit inside a nice, neat, and tidy box. And I think we as social workers, I think we come to this profession because we see people outside of that, and we see people, and try to see people for who they are. I mentioned that I worked as a pediatric social worker. Prior to that, I worked in eMERGE at Royal Columbian Hospital, which some of you may know is the main trauma response for the region. So we saw a lot of major accidents, drunk driving, addictions, homeless, everything. I have a spinal cord injury, and when I wanted to have a family, there was very little information about women with spinal cord injuries in pregnancy. A lot of information was out there about men. Again, probably because of my social work hat, I sought out that information. I kind of knew the system, and I fought, and I pushed, and asked my family doctor if I could be referred, or I told my family doctor I wanted to get pregnant. She's like, most people in your situation wouldn't take that on. I said, well, I'm not most people. So this is where you need to refer me to. It's the Maternal Fetal Medicine Clinic at BC Women's. Here is the form, please sign. I will fax it, thank you. But I work in the system, and I knew that. I knew how to do that. So after I had my son, I realized there still wasn't any information. I had built a team for myself, but there wasn't a lot available for us. So I wanted to help other moms. So I pulled together that group of people, and everybody's kind of like, it's coming off beside my desk, or I don't have time. And I had lofty ideas of what I could do during a maternity leave, so I wasn't able to do a lot either when my son was really little. But then we decided to have a second, and 4 years later, by the time I had her. And again, there was no information again, and I was like, okay, this is a problem, because I raised this issue, and nobody's done anything. So I started this spinal cord injury perinatal interest group, which we recognize spells the acronym PIG, which is unfortunate, but that's okay. We play with it, we get the little pig in a wheelchair as well. All that to say is that when you see a gap, and even if it's a gap that's really just for a really tiny group, it's important to try and make a change and make a difference, because for that group, that one gap might be their entire heart. So for me, having a family was so important. And yes, I was just one woman out of, there's 350 people with spinal cord injuries, say, in a year, and I was one of those women, and one of the few women with childbearing years. But for me, it was really, really important. So with that little group, so I pulled together a little group of people. There's 5 of us on that committee. We all do it. I do it volunteer. The rest of my group does it off the side of their desk. And we've created a booklet for women that is all the things to consider during pregnancy, so all the things we've learned along the way, both from my experience and other moms' experience. We have a brochure that we give to families. We have a YouTube video about that being a mom is possible after a spinal cord injury. We present it internationally, nationally, and locally. That's all just done by a really small group for a really small population. So I think, as you said, Angie, it's recognizing that our clients aren't just our clients. Things that happen to them don't just happen to them. They happen to their family and their community. So how do you build your networks? How do you draw on that to make a difference? And again, it seemed at different points in time that it was never going to happen, or we fell into our comfort zone of doing a lot of education for professionals because we're more comfortable talking to our peers, and that felt safe and easy. And I really pushed, no, we need to get the information out to the women that need it. So how do we do that? And I think you guys can do that in all of your areas of interest or areas of practice. Is where are those gaps? And what's something small we can start with to do, and how do we build on it? Does that kind of make sense? I'm sorry, I keep saying that at the end of every question.
I just want to add one point. What Sharon said is, cancer is really important. It's the power of peer-to-peer support. This informal network is really, really crucial to really make changes. Professionals can push so much, but we need to really form alliance with people who are using the services. And the peer-to-peer support resources, as I say, this is the most effective way to bring some of the changes that we want to see.
Thank you. I think the first network you really want to consider is look around. There's 140 people here. They will be in the field with you 2 years later, most of them. So if you know them here at the school, then they will be your access in the field. right? This is the beginning investment you should have, okay? Make sure that you connect with people here. Anyone want to follow up with what they said? It's really interesting. Yes, just a sec.
I have a question.
Can you introduce yourself, please?
My name is Hannah. I'm going to third year. And I have a question about how often is it that you feel like you need to go to your peers or your coworkers and ask them for support because of the stories you hear from your clients and just the amount of emotional stuff you go through with your work?
Daily. I'm lucky. I think that's what's nice about working in a team environment. I often go to my social work colleagues for support, but I sometimes will go to other colleagues for a different perspective of things as well. I think it is really. I also I did stay connected with. I did my graduate degree at UBC, and I stayed connected with a number of probably half of the class of students that I had at that time, and they've become my network. It's their fault that I'm here because two of my fellow students nominated me for this award. So I think maintaining those connections is important. I had said earlier, having the courage to be vulnerable, it's really scary. I'm really nervous still to go to a colleague and be very honest and say, you know what, I think I really screwed that up. Yeah. I think I messed up in that client interaction. I think now that I'm a little further into my practice, I have a trusting relationship, so I can be honest with a select number of people. Finding out who those people are, because it's only when you allow yourself to be really vulnerable and examine what you did wrong that you can change and make a difference the next time. If you keep kind of pushing it to the side, you're not growing from those experiences. Does that? I think that kind of speaks to burnout too. The colleagues that I know really well, I'm not always aware of the early stages of burnout. I tend to go, burnout, crash and burn, go, crash and burn. So I've now learned to ask some of my friends, if you see me kind of starting to creep towards the edge, can you tell me? Like, can you say, Karen, you know, I think you need a break, or Karen, maybe you need to go do something that you enjoy. And that's been really helpful too. My husband kind of just tugs on his ear at the dinner table, like, okay, Karen, you're really done. And then I think once you're out in the field, is trying to spread out your vacation time or your time off so that you get frequent breaks over. It seems nice, and it depends on your style. For me, I thought that 3 weeks at a time would be awesome to get a full break. I've learned that doesn't work very well for me. I actually have to take like a week in March, there's a Cape Breton accent, a week in the summer, so that I can look forward to having breaks as well and can kind of reset and regroup.
Well, you know, I have reference group all over the world. I talk to lots of people. I always say, share the pain. If I have trouble, I talk to people that I respect. You know, like I have connections with, I have a category 5. If I have problem in this area, I call so-and-so. It could be somebody internally from my work. It could be somebody that I learned throughout my professional life. And, you know, like years ago, I was working to bring abilities online, which is, an internet system to connect children with disabilities, an online support system. And I get to learn, and get to know the psychiatrist, Dr. Annette Defebb, who actually ended up having the Order of Canada for her work in supporting children with disabilities. She worked with sick kids. And I have to tell you, for a while, I talked to her in 3 days. I'm online, not on the phone, but we also have knowledge gap. We also have questions. It's really important, like Karen said. I learned years ago from the Larian psychology, the courage to be imperfect. You know, like, to be able to acknowledge areas that we need support is really important, even to your clients. If you make a mistake, own it up to the clients. They're actually very forgiving. The only way that they won't be forgiving is that you pretend that it's not there. You know, I always tell my staff too, It's always okay to mistake, to make mistake. Try your best not to make the same mistake the second time. And make sure you don't do it the third time. The same mistake. You can make all kinds of mistakes because we are human. Nobody's perfect. So that years for years, I have this poster in my office, the courage to be imperfect, because sometimes it's really hard, and you look at, I mean, to be reflective of your practice is really important, to be able to say to yourself, how did I screw this one up so wildly? You know, because we all do, you know, like that's just being part of humans.
Thank you. Any other questions? Anyone want to? Oh, sorry. Oh, sorry. Oh, did we miss the hand? Oh.
So this is kind of the, similar. I was wondering how you deal with frustration, your own as well as your client's frustration, especially when it's due to a gap in the system that you cannot do anything about and that they cannot do anything about, and how you get it straight, explaining to your clients that this is not you failing as a social worker, but it's actually, the system that's not working.
Okay, before the answer, can you introduce yourself?
Yes, of course, I'm Deborah. I'm doing an internship at the BC Association of Social Workers. I'm a social worker in Germany, and I'm also studying in Germany.
Welcome to Canada.
How do you deal with frustration? Well, like, I think that when we work with clients, as I say, I always tell clients what's possible and what's not possible. You know, and sometimes if it's because of policy, it's because of, you know, the restraint of what we're able to do and what we're not able to do. Well, I think that, you know, we can understand the challenges and the frustration the person has. We might problem solve to see whether there's other ways of, you know, addressing the issues. But sometimes we just have to say, this is a good area to spend our energy to advocate for. It may not solve tomorrow, it might not solve the day after tomorrow. I have to tell you, there are times that I'm thinking about solutions, not for days, not for weeks, not for months, but for a long, long time, like, you know, like for years. I really want to do a program on, you know, like promoting social emotional competency for children with disabilities, and, you know, there's a lot of talk about social emotional competency for children in typical classroom, but we know working with our children with a typical neurodevelopmental profile is a very different story. And sometimes the school programs, you know, like the mindfulness, you know, like those self-regulations don't work really well. And there's not really that lot of programs outside, you know, like, you know, in any setting. So I can tell you, I worked on it for 3 years before we got the money for that project. You know, like, so just don't give up. Form alliance, you know, like, really talk to people with similar ideas, similar needs. Form coalition. Those, because, you know, like, I mean, there are lots of, I mean, in work, there's lots of frustration. You know, there's a lot of challenges, but I always learn from what Donna taught me. You know, like, you just have to keep pushing it and keep dreaming possibilities, because if you give up, then nothing is going to change.
I think it's really interesting to hear you I think there's kind of two layers to it. I think in the moment, dealing with the frustration, I think for me, again, goes back to going beyond the script of when someone says, I'm so angry, I hate this. Why? What's happened? What's going on for you? What would help you feel better? What would be different? Because I think you have to recognize that frustration and anger to just say, oh, well, there's going to be a program in a couple of years. That in that moment, people can't hear that, or that's
not always the most helpful. I think we do that further in that process to give them hope. So I think it is creating that space. I try to leave my own frustration with the system at the door as much as I can, and to talk with families and be there, but to still provide hope. I think what leads to frustration for a lot of clients is the lack of feeling they have a lack of control or a lack of choice. So looking at their situation, having them tell me more, and then trying to figure out, is there anywhere within that situation where they have a little bit of choice? So they're frustrated and they're upset that they can't get an appointment with a specialist until February, but do they have some control over whether it's in the morning or the afternoon so that they can get their kids to school? Or like just some sense of something. Or saying, you know what, I know you're really frustrated that you can't get until September. Have you thought about maybe calling and seeing if you can get on a wait list? Because then it gives them a little bit of control. It gives them that opening to say, I'm putting myself there, and then it's up to them to call back. I think as social workers, we deal with frustration, our own, our clients, our colleagues, constantly. So figuring out ways to manage it and how to cope with it and figuring out ways to channel it in ways that are productive and helpful is really important.
I think the first step is to acknowledge they're frustrated. Because if somebody is frustrated, it's no use to talk them out. They shouldn't be feeling frustrated. Because if they're frustrated, if people want to scream it down, that's really the prerogative to do so. And, you know, like, why shouldn't they? I would be in the same situation. I always tell the people or families that, well, my patient is not my middle name.
I want to follow up with that. You both talk about burnout, you talk about stress, you talk about frustration, how to handle that. But you both work in the field for a long time. What keep you in the field? Why do you still want to be a social worker?
I have to tell you, I never feel burnout. I may be upset, I may be stressed, I may be worried, I may, you know, like just feel like screaming and yelling, which I sometimes do. But I never feel burnout because I think that I believe that I cannot solve all the like problem by myself. It's really about collaborations. It's really about how we join together with families, with clients, with colleagues to do problem solving. In fact, it's really interesting. I always believe that, you know, we need, you know, like there's always saying it takes a community to raise a child. It takes the community to solve the problem too. So how do I, you know, deal with my frustration and stress? I have my, you know, tools, a series of tools that I use. First of all, I have a very supportive husband who is a social worker, and I know that if I get really upset, he always tries to calm me down. He's a calm person. And also, as I say, my reference group, I call them up and I talk to them, share the pain, you know, share the gain. And I have my own time that is very important to me. And every day I have my time that faith is very important to me. Every time I do say, you know, every morning that I meditate, I say my prayers, it's very important to me. And on the weekend, no matter how busy I am, I always have, you know, like brunch with my husband. That is the time that even if I have a deadline of a big proposal due tomorrow, I'd rather get up at 5 o'clock to do my work because that brunch is important to me. So I do different things that is really important for, you know, like talk to my nieces, you know, like that is always a relief. Have fun. It's really important to have fun. You know, we all need to have fun, and whatever is fun for you, what you do. You don't do what's fun for somebody else, right? And then that doesn't help.
The guy have brunch with her is sitting right here.
As I said earlier, I burn out all the time. And on all my performance reviews, one of the comments has always been, needs to practice better self-care. So I think you're going to need a diversity of people within the field as well. Some people are awesome at self-care and do their yoga, and some people are less skilled at it. I think the question was, what keeps me in social work practice? My husband actually designs iPhone games and has his own company called Stinger Games, and I often joke with him when I've had a rough couple of weeks. I'm like, so you're going to change your company name to Stinger Games and Crafts. And then I'm going to sell my quilts and my superhero pens. Yeah, no. So then I can't do it, so I have to go to work and get a paycheck. I think what keeps it in for me is, for me, I went into social work because I believe, I think what's important to me about social work is the power of relationships. And I think part of social work is building relationships all the time. So you're meeting somebody for the first time, you're building a relationship and a rapport with them. You're building a relationship with your team all the time. You're building relationships with your community partners. You don't want to push so hard for one client that you burn a bridge, because 2 days later you might need to call that same service to access it for a different client in a different situation. So you have to learn how to tread gently, I think. I think for me, focusing on the relationship rather than the fixes is what keeps me in social work, because relationships are changing and dynamic all the time, and it's something that I can always strive for and work for. I can't always fix it, but I can. So there's a quote that I have kind of posted in my office, and it's, it's something along the lines, I'm going to get it wrong, but if I go to bed at night knowing that I made even a small difference, if I made a small difference in someone's life and made them feel even a little bit better, then it's been a good day. So I've learned not to complain that I've had a horrendous awful day, because in social work, according to that quote, I rarely have a horrendous awful day. I often have just a good day instead of an amazing or spectacular day. Right? I'm always trying to do that little bit of good.
Thank you. Good. You got a mic behind. Quick.
Hello. My name is Nyla. My question is, do you often have to advocate for social work profession, for example, for other professionals or people who think that social work is not that important?
Yes, often. I think you don't want to set hard lines for your turf, but you also have to fight for what's your area of practice. So, and sometimes that might involve some difficult conversations, but I think fortunately, we're skilled at how to have those difficult conversations with clients, and you can apply that to have those difficult conversations with colleagues. So I work part-time, split between three teams, so I don't get to see every family, and often there are families that get missed, and when I notice that, I do have to go to that colleague and say, why didn't you call me, or why didn't you let me know? And, oh, well, I talked to them and they seemed okay. I'm like, well, we're not sure if they were okay, like, you know, in the future. So I think it's kind of that education and collaborating piece that becomes part of that. It's tough. I think too, as Andrew said, oftentimes new positions will be created and management think, oh, that can be a nurse's position or that can be such and such a position. And so I know that we frontline social work often will go through kind of what are the job description for something new, and if we think that it's a match with social work, then we'll actually go to our professional practice lead and say, you know, they're thinking about hiring so-and-so, like this type of professional for this job. We really think that it's a real fit with social worker and really complements what we do. Is there something that you can do to help us out? And then kind of using, again, your network and the people that are higher above to push that agenda to kind of get things through. You have more experience in the management then.
Well, I think a lot of time in the line work, what you do make a difference. And if you are doing a great job, you know, we have social workers on our team, and not everybody is, you know, is created equal. That, you know, I can tell you that there's some social workers are lining up because every team member is referring to them. So don't underestimate how you model the importance of social work by what you do. Because, you know, if you do great work, people are gonna acknowledge it. You know, like, of course, there are going to be challenges, like Karen is saying. But, you know, like, especially for the clients, because, you know, for the people that you support. I mean, more and more, like, when we do program renovations, we get feedback directly from families and from clients. And if every single client and every single family says, the social worker's help is tremendous. It makes a difference in my life. If everybody say that in the program evaluation and survey, those words get to our administration. Those words go to the leadership team. You know, because that is the feedback more important than what you say and what your supervisors say and what your team leaders say.
Well, I think number one thing I learned from what you just said is, as a social worker, we have to earn the credibility. before we can really push. If you don't have the credibility, you didn't get your work done, what are you pushing? Right? So I think that's something, you know, we have to show. Okay, social work is unique, we can contribute, and we do contribute. This is very important to us. Any questions before I ask the last question to our guests? Anyone want to give a quick feedback or comment to what they have shared with you?
Way too quiet.
Exactly.
I have a question.
Yeah, good. Yeah.
Hello, my name is Jessica. My question is, how do you address complacency within an agency? So complacency, like how within an agency to address kind of change? Because often I find that change in policy can become very difficult and you just kind of want to keep things the way that they are. And like how we advocate for clients to advocate within for change can often be very difficult because policy, attempting to change policy is often a brick wall. How can you address that?
It has to do a little bit about the leadership in the organization. Because right now, when the money in the government is so stretched, accountability is really important. You know, like change is two aspects. One is, you know, like changing policy, you know, like there's also the whole emotional and psychological transitions of doing things different. People need a lot of support to do that. And, you know, and on top of that, people need to understand the reason and the rationale why you're doing those changes. You know, like if people are in the happy profession, which I think social workers are and also our teams are, well, how well are we using the resources, maximize the resources to support the people that we are providing service with? You know, like that, you know, there's a whole, you know, like continuum of, you know, dialogue that has to happen within, you know, this, the organization from between department, among staff, you know, what is, you know, and it has to be a planning and collaborative process. You have a really great question because years ago when I was still the director of social work, I was very interested in change management because you wonder, okay, you're doing this, everybody's up in arms, nobody really wanna do it, you know, like geez, you know, like here come the management again doing these things. So this, I remember that was, you know, I was always wondering what we can do differently. And when I was spending my Christmas holiday in California with my brother, I was reading this book by William Bridges called Managing Organization Transitions. And I said to myself, here's a lot of really interesting to say. How do you have to have an ending to give up what you're doing practice, and there's going to be a whole time of transitions that he called the neutron zone, that people are still trying to experimenting and before we come up to a new beginning. So I spent a lot of time, you know, having dialogue with this. I actually, because, you know, at that time, Bill Bridges, his main office is in Mill Valley, which is very close to where I was staying with my brother. I actually drove up and met him. I went up and knocked on his, and went to his office, told his secretaries that I'm from Canada, I read his book, I really want to talk to him. So, and maybe he can give us some tips. And you know, like the conversations, the casual conversations that last for half an hour, end up that I talk, you know, like talk my executive director at the time to bring him up to Canada and work with our team to talk about change management. Because, you know, like in change management, you do need some, you know, buy-in from the leadership. You know, that is really important.
It's one thing to demand change, it's another thing to offer to be part of the change. So I think when you're demanding change, people don't like that because you're pretty much telling them that what they're doing is wrong. But if you say that you want to be part of the change and you want to be part of making something and figuring out what the lingo is in your agency or what is the buy-in for them to want to change. So in a hospital setting, accreditation is a big deal. So making sure that we pass accreditation every couple of years is really important. So I will often pitch changes using the language of that accreditation. So in order to meet the accreditation standard of transitions, we need to make sure that we're doing a better job of X, Y, and Z. Oh, so, and I'm willing to be part of a focus group that'll work on that. I think when we just say, you need to change this, people put up their walls really quickly and get really defensive. So it's a way, it's figuring out a way to come alongside people and then help guide that change.
Thank you. I believe we have one more person want to can you raise your hand? Yeah.
My name is Jacqueline. Actually, part of my question has already been covered, but I'm just wondering, is there any way to lobby the government who are probably the greatest policy implementers for supporting people with disability?
I think right now there's ongoing lobbying by different groups. Like for example, you know, like next year's election year, there's a lot of, you know, lobbying going on at this moment. You know, like agency like Inclusion BC, you know, and Coalition for People with Disabilities, and there's a lot of parents groups. Really, you know, like when you look at what government does, you need people who are using the service to be vocal. For service providers and for, you know, like professionals to advocate, it's important, but it's less effective than people with disabilities to do that advocating, because they always think that we might be just have a conflict of interest. We're just looking for money to expand our agency. Whereas, you know, for person with disabilities, it's a lot, look at the officer group. Look at the power of their lobby. They got pretty good services because they have a very strong, powerful lobbying, parenting, parents groups.
Speaking for myself as a frontline staff, it is hard to lobby at the government level without getting in trouble. Because I can't be really outright in it because I can't be seen as speaking for the agency or representing the agency when I'm fighting for something for a change within that. So you get to be, again, creative in how you go about things in the side as opposed to attacking from the top. So how do you support families to join, to giving families information about groups in the community or clients information about groups in the community where they can learn to advocate and they can learn to bring those worries and concerns higher up, because that's often what we're wanting to fight for is what the family's worries are. I think using your professional associates, like the BC Association for Social Workers, has a number of great committees and has people that can help with that lobbying work and can bring that larger voice. One small voice is just a little whisper in the crowd, but if you have a large group of the entire province of social workers is saying that we need something, that's a lot stronger and that's a lot more provocative to try and get a change.
Okay, I have the last question. Since the audience are all social work students, do you have two or three ideas that you can help them to prepare themselves, not only to be a good social worker, but a social worker who can inspire the people?
First of all, take advantage of your education. Learn as much as you could while you're in school. Don't take just the easy subject, take the hard one. Because it's a lot harder to learn, you know, the hard subject on your own. I would strongly recommend that you take the step course. And you know why? Because you want to be able to appraise research articles to see what's a good, you know, evidence-based practice. Without that knowledge, it's very difficult. You don't want to learn that course while you finish your school and you have to read a book on stats. It's not the easiest thing. You know, like, you know, social work in healthcare anyway, best practice, evidence-based practice has become very crucial. It's really about accountability. We are doing things that truly make a difference. So, you know, the more you learn about, you know, like how to appraise good, you know, interventions, the better it is. Social work is a lifelong learning. So even when we graduate, keep your professional development. I tell you, I still up to do today. Read 2 hours of articles every week. Because it's really important to keep up, especially when you are working with you know, a multidisciplinary team, because other people are going to challenge you. Where do you get that idea? You know, how do you know this is a good practice? You need those informations. So I think that it's really important to really, I mean, you graduate, take advantage of the school, but when you graduate, you continue to really, it's a lifelong learning. I was very interested in Larian psychology after I graduated from my master's degree program. I actually went back and finished the whole master in Larian psychology. The only thing I didn't do was to take the exam, because I thought I already have a degree, I don't want to take the exam. But you know, learning is important, I think, and also learn beyond the scope of social work, because in the field that I am in, I do learn a little bit about, you know, human development, child development, because how do you know if the kid is doing age-appropriate things if you don't know what the human, you know, development is like? So whatever field you go in, expand your scope, learn more. That's my suggestion.
On a practical level, I would encourage students consider using your practicum placements to try something outside your comfort zone. Because it's the one time in your lives where you'll have support to do that. So you'll have your whole classmates, you have your field coordinator person, as well as your practicum supervisor in the location. So for me, in my BSW, I ended up doing a placement with, it was called second stage housing. So it was helping homeless youth in Ottawa move from living on the streets to stable housing. I grew up in Cape Breton where we didn't really have homeless youth. So people lived with their neighbors or next door, or it wasn't very visible. So for me, it was totally outside of my comfort zone. I knew nothing. I had a client that told me that his brother and sister were doing this, and another brother and sister were doing that. And I said to my supervisor, "Wow, he has a really big family." And she's like, "It's his street family." So, but it was a chance to learn that in a way that was supportive, and I didn't get fired because I didn't know what I was doing. I was supported to learn throughout it. And then my master's placement, I had the amazing opportunity to do a placement at Connect Place Children's Hospice, working with children that have life-limiting illnesses. And so for me, that was really hard. I had a lot of friends that I met when I was in hospital who died at a young age. I wanted to learn, though. I wanted to experience it. But I knew for me to do a career in that area would be really, really difficult. But to do a placement was manageable. I had access to counseling services here. I had access to my peers. And so it really helped broaden. And I draw on those skills and those things that I learned now in my practice. So that's one thing that I would encourage you to do. Or if you can't do it in your practicum, volunteering. Again, you're not likely to get fired from a volunteer position. You're more likely to get fired from a job, which looks worse on your resume. So learning. I think to go back to the burnout question, I think what's wonderful about social work practice is there's so many areas of practice as well. So I felt really, really burnt out working in Emerge. I worked 3 to 11 at night dealing with trauma after trauma after trauma. So I didn't burn out to the point that I was unhealthy or unwell. I recognized that this wasn't the best fit anymore and was able to go working where I work now in outpatient care, which is a better fit for me. So I think I'm thinking about what's the best fit for you, but recognizing that you don't have to be stuck in something forever, there are opportunities to move within the profession.
Okay. Thank you very much for both. I hope you have learned something today. Have you? So what should we do if we learn something from some wonderful people?